Great Depression left the American people shattered and hopeless. However, that did not mean that there was no cause for hope. In the election of 1933, Franklin D. Roosevelt made promises of a new deal that would help put America back on its feet. After winning the election, Roosevelt went to work on his promise almost immediately. In March 9th of 1933, the Emergency Banking Act was enacted. It closed banks until they had been inspected and determined as healthy. In 3 days, within 3/4 of the previously closed banks had been able to reopen, thus reinstating the faith of the Americans in the banking system. The Economy Act of 1933 was enacted on March 20th. It was an act of Congress that cut government salaries and veteran pensions. It didn't seem like a good idea because of the bonus army, but Roosevelt had some more ideas for jobs up his sleeves. On June 16, 1933, the Banking Act was enacted. It included the Glass-Steagall Act, which separated commercial banking from investment banking. It also created the FDIC, or Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, as a temporary government corporation. It gave the FDIC the authority to provide deposit insurance to banks and to regulate and supervise state non-member banks. The FDIC was funded with initial loans of $289 million throughout the U.S. Treasury and the FRB. The act extended federal oversight to all commercial banks for the first time and prohibited banks from paying interest on checking accounts. Often referred to as the Truth in Securities Law, the Securities Act of 1933 had two basic objectives: to require that investors receive financial and other significant information concerning securities being offered for public sale, and prohibit deceit, misrepresentations, and other fraud in the sale of securities. The Securities Act also established the SEC, or Securities and Exchange Commission, whose goal was to protect investors, maintain fair, orderly, and efficient markets, and facilitate capital formation. The National Industrial Recovery Act, or the NIRA, was enacted by Congress in June 1933 and was one of the measures by which President Roosevelt sought to assist the nation's economic recovery during the Great Depression. The passage of the NIRA ushered a unique experiment in U.S. economic history. The NIRA sanction-supported and, in some cases, enforced an alliance of industries. Antitrust laws were suspended, and companies were required to write industry-wide codes of fair competition that effectively fixed prices and wages, established production quotas, and imposed restrictions on the entry of other companies into alliances. The act further called for industrial self-regulation and declared that codes of fair competition for the protection of consumers, competitors, and employers were to be drafted for the various industries of the country and were to be subject to public hearings. The Public Works Administration, or PWA, was designed to reduce unemployment and increase purchasing power through the construction of highways and other public works. It was authorized by the NIRA and was led by the Secretary of the Interior, Harold L. X. During its existence, the PWA spent about $4 billion in the construction of more than 70% of the nation's new buildings, 65% of its new courthouses, city halls, and sewage disposal plants, 35% of its new public health facilities, and 10% of all new roads, bridges, and subways. The Resettlement Administration was a federal agency that between April 1935 and December 1936 relocated struggling urban and rural families to communities planned by the federal government. However, not all families were able to move. Many families were bound to the land that they already owned. The Rural Electrification Administration of 1936 provided federal loans for the installation of electrical distribution systems to serve isolated rural areas of the United States. The funding was channeled through cooperative electric power companies, most of which still exist today. As most of the New Deal acts, this provided many jobs, with people putting in power lines and putting up poles. Nationally, the administration was an agency that focused on providing work and education for Americans between the ages of 16 and 25. It operated from June 26, 1935 to 1939 as a part of the Works Progress Administration. This was mainly in response to the number of young Americans who left their homes because they felt that their parents could no longer afford to keep them. The Civilian Conservation Corps was a public work relief program that operated from 1933 to 1942. It was for unemployed, unmarried men from relief families and originally was for young men from ages 18 to 23, but was eventually expanded to young men ages 17 to 28. It was a major part of the development of the New Deal, and it provided unskilled manual labor jobs related to the conservation and development of natural resources in rural lands owned by federal, state, and local governments. The CCC was designed to provide jobs for young men to relieve families who had difficulty finding jobs during the Depression, while at the same time implementing a general natural resource conservation program in every state and territory. Maximum enrollment at one time was at 300,000. In 9 years, 3 million young men participated in the CCC, which provided them with shelter, clothing, and food, together with a small wage of $30 a month. The Tennessee Valley Administration was one of the most ambitious projects of the New Deal in its overall conception. Its comprehensive nature encompassed many of FDR's own interests in conservation, public utility, regulation, regional planning, agricultural development, and social and economic improvement of the forgotten Americans. The TVA encountered many setbacks and failures. It was involved in many controversies, but it brought electricity to thousands of people at an affordable price. It controlled the floodwaters of the Tennessee River and improved navigation. It introduced modern agricultural techniques. The Agricultural Adjustment Act, or the AAA, controlled the supply of 7 basic crops: corn, wheat, cotton, rice, peanuts, tobacco, and milk, by offering payments to farmers in return for taking some of their land out of farming, not planting crops. The AAA also wanted to restrict the number of crops that farmers could plant each year, and restrict the number of livestock. However, the Supreme Court ruled the AAA as constitutional, but the basic program was rewritten and again passed into law. Even critics admitted that the AAA and related laws helped revive hope in farm communities. Farmers were put on local committees and spoke their minds. Government checks began to flow. The AAA did not end the Depression and drought, but the legislation remained the basis for all farm programs in the following 70 years of the 20th century. The Home Owners Loan Corporation helped to stabilize real estate that had depreciated during the Depression, and to refinance the urban mortgage debt. It granted long-term mortgage loans from some 1 million homeowners facing loss of their property. The HOLC ceased its lending activities in June 1936 by the term of the Home Owners Loan Act.
The Social Security Act of August 14, 1935 was an act to provide for the general welfare by establishing a system of federal old age benefits and by enabling the several states to make more adequate provision for aged persons, blind persons, dependent and crippled children, maternal and child welfare, public health, and the administration of their unemployment compensation laws, to establish a Social Security Board, to raise revenue, and for other purposes. The Wagner Act was signed into law on July 5, 1935. It established the National Labor Relations Board, or the NLRB, and addressed relations between unions and employers in the private sector. The FLSA, or the Fair Labor Standards Act, established a minimum wage, overtime pay, record keeping, and youth employment standards affecting employees in the private sector and in federal, state, and local governments. This assured the American people that they would indeed have the wages that they deserved and that they didn't have to worry about sending their children to work. The Works Progress Administration was a relief measure established in 1935 by executive order as part of the Works Progress Administration and was redesigned in 1939 when it was transferred to the Federal Works Agency. Headed by Harry L. Hopkins and supplied with an initial congressional appropriation of over $4 billion, it offered work to the unemployed on an unprecedented scale by spending money on a wide variety of programs, including highways and building construction, slum clearance, reforestation, and rural rehabilitation.